μας, τον Γιώργο Γκιαούρη, που μιλάει εκ μέρους ενός τεράστιου παίκτη σε αυτό το χώρο, της EBRD. Προσπάθησα να βρω την ελληνική μετάφραση του EBRD, Ευρωπαϊκή Τράπεζα Ανασυγκρότησης και Ανάπτυξης. Καλώς ορίσατε.
Σωστά.
Σας έχετε το λόγο. Ευχαριστώ.
Ευχαριστώ, Παύλο. Ευχαριστώ και τους organizers. Thanks a lot to everyone. Good afternoon. Thank you for inviting me on this very interesting workshop and also allowing to present EBRD's role and how we can support the offshore wind development in Greece. Allow me to start with the priorities of EBRD on the energy sector and how offshore wind fits very well. I mean, we promote decarbonization, scaling up of renewables, and moving away our countries from coal, and supporting also the coal-dependent regions to transition to new economic activities. A very good example is our recent financing. We financed the largest solar PV park with Hellenic Petroleum in Greece, the 204 megawatt solar park in Kozani last year. And we also support companies adopt higher corporate governance and climate risk reporting standards. We promote higher environmental and social standards and practices to our projects. And of course, we promote competitive, liquid, and well interconnected markets. In Greece, we have invested in the establishment of the energy exchange, a very small investment, but an institution with an important role for the development of the electricity markets in Greece. And we have financed a number of physical interconnections in Southeastern Europe. And offshore wind development definitely plays a very important role for scaling up renewables and, of course, achieving the decarbonization targets. The key driver for offshore wind development was highlighted a lot previously, comes from the new EU Green Deal targets and also the new offshore renewable energy strategy, which sets an ambitious target of up to 60 gigawatt by 2030, increasing to 300 gigawatt by 2050. The EU offshore renewable strategy recognizes the great potential to scale up offshore wind, and such a potential comes at a time where the levelized cost of electricity for offshore wind is also decreasing significantly, as it was mentioned earlier by Giles and the rest of the speakers. It also recognizes the important role of the maritime spatial planning and the need to develop offshore wind in coexistence with other activities and also on a sustainable, environmental sustainable manner. We at EBRD has not financed, of course, yet offshore wind. It's a very new area for our countries that we operate. We don't operate in Western Europe, but in our country, we see the first steps now being taken towards promoting the legislation that will support the offshore wind development. Poland being in the forefront and having recently adopted their Offshore Wind Act, which sets a target of 6 gigawatt of capacity to be given financial support this year and then follow up with auctions for CFD. Romania and Bulgaria at an earlier stage of developing their legislation. We've also taken note of a recent EU-supported study for the Mediterranean region, which shows the huge potential that offshore wind and floating offshore wind can play for Greece, setting the theoretical potential to 260 gigawatt by 2030. So definitely offshore wind has a huge potential for Greece. And also not only it can address Greece's decarbonization targets, but it can also provide an opportunity for green recovery from COVID. And as mentioned from the previous speaker, Mr. Zervos, it can provide opportunities for wider business activities and the boost for local economic activities, particularly for the floating offshore wind, where a lot of the development activities take place in the ports. So for Greece to be able to harness most of that potential, it's therefore very important to set an ambitious offshore wind development strategy with a clear targets and pipeline. And we propose such ambitious pipeline and targets to be part of the next revision of the National Energy and Climate Plan. And as mentioned by Alpha Bank, I mean, as you and you will expect from financier, we would like to also repeat some of the key challenges for developing offshore wind, particularly in the floating. So we recognize that there are a number of construction and operating risks, especially since the early state of development of the floating offshore wind, and that's why it is required to work with reputable and experienced developers and contractors. On the interconnection, it was mentioned earlier, the need to design the right model of responsibilities between TSOs and developers that try to eliminate the risk of delays and cost overruns. And remuneration, of course, CFD options is the preferred option and it works very well in Greece, so it is great to build on the existing CFD scheme, but of course, provide better planning for the operating support required, especially for the floating offshore wind. And on the permitting and environmental issues, the need to provide for flexible permitting in order to accommodate the technological development. There is today sufficient experience from the development and financing of bottom fixed offshore wind, but given the emergence of the floating offshore wind, the importance of attracting experienced developers and contractors is even more critical. And I'm really pleased to see a number of experienced developers taking part in this event today. What is the role of EBRD? As we have played an important role for the developing of onshore renewables in our countries, we see again our role for offshore wind, focusing on three main areas: policy dialogue. Not only we promote sustainable energy development, but we play the honest broker role, balancing the needs of developers and policymakers and sharing experience and best practices. A couple of weeks ago, we organized together with Wind Europe a workshop. We invited a number of international experts on floating offshore wind to discuss with the Greek Ministry of Environment and Energy best practices for offshore wind development in other EU countries. We also mobilized technical cooperation, grants for studies to develop regulatory frameworks, drafting contracts like PPAs, designing auctions. This is one activity that we are very active these days in Southeast Europe. We can support grid capacity studies, strategic environmental assessment. We can even provide a project preparation facility where we can help take a site, prepare it to be auctioned as a concession for a design, build, own and operate model as a concession. And we can design the model together with the public authority. And of course, we can provide financing on the project after having supported a bankable regulatory framework. We can provide a range of different products from project financing, mezzanine debt, corporate loans, equity or investing in bonds, like the recent example of the solar PV park in Kozani. And I'll close my presentation with two important remarks. I will repeat what I mentioned earlier. The importance of designing a regulatory framework that can attract experienced developers, especially given the potential of the of Greece's offshore wind being on floating, which has still some technological challenges. So the need for attracting experienced developers is even higher. And second, the need for Greece to demonstrate its ambition and pipeline and targets, ideally reflected in the National Energy Climate Plan. And that will help actually create the scale and the synergy that will bring the cost down, especially for the floating offshore wind. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm ready to participate on the discussion.
George, great. Thank you very, very much. Can I just ask one small question from based on what you said about project financing, project management or design? Is that to the government or to the developers or private sort of
project preparation facility? Yes, we work with a public authority, the authority which usually undertakes the let's say the auction to run the process. It's more classic on our I would say infrastructure projects. For example, we have provided such assistance for dry ports in Egypt recently. So we select the site, we prepare. We don't do the studies for the project. This is for sure for the developer, but we do the preliminary work, yeah, and prepare a project that can be auctioned as a concept. This is one option. I'm not suggesting that this is the right model, but this is also one of the support that we can bring if a government chooses to go through a pilot and they would like to provide us more, I would say, prepared process to the developer as possible.
Yes, and how about the environmental studies and consulting?
You know, we can, of course, carry out the preliminary environmental, strategic environmental assessment. And of course, if we are talking on a specific site, we can also help the detailed environmental impact assessment. But of course, up to a certain level, because then you need to link to this particular design, which of course the developer will have to propose.
That's very important, because as we heard from Alexandra Zdouku, everything has to happen very quickly. So there needs to be a lot of resources in the next 3 to 6 months if we are to design something. And therefore, we need to work very quickly, and that's expensive. But it's good to know that there are sources of funding. Yeah. Fantastic. Thank you very much. I'm sure we'll come back to your presentation, George. So thank you very much.